Thank you very much for that, Rich. It's me, Tim Willoughby, here with Ian Duke from R&D. And Ian, just one more round of limited left to go before we hit our final five constructed rounds here at Pro Tour Kaladesh. We've heard that the players down the feature match area are all ready to go. All but one of these players in the feature match area has yet to pick up a loss in these draft rounds here at the first Pro Tour of the season. Let's head down to the feature match area and see who can make it a perfect run. Hello and welcome to this round 11 here at Pro Tour Kaladesh. I'm Tim Willoughby, joined by R&D member Ian Duke. And our feature match area are replete with limited talents here. All but one of the players in this feature match area have yet to drop a match of limited. And we're going to be starting off with some of the best players in the game right now. First up, we have that man there, Martin Muller of Denmark. He's been on the World Magic Cup winning team for his nation and a very important player on Team Eureka. But up against him, well, he's got one of this year's Hall of Fame inductees. That's Owen Turtenwald. He started off the day with a 3-0 in draft, hit a rocky spot with his constructed deck, but is very much rocking and rolling again now that he's playing with a 40-card deck. A lot of power in the deck that he's brought to the table here. So we can see Owen Turtenwald starting things off in red-blue. It's actually red-green from Martin Muller, who's a little bit slow off on the uptake there with his first play of the game. Ideally, you want that Inventor's Apprentice on turn one, and it immediately falling there to Chandra's Pyro Helix because no artifact in play means it's just a 1-2. So it looks like there's some stumbles on mana here for Martin Muller. Owen Turtenwald's deck, not the one that's going to be super-duper aggressive here, but he has a lot of power at the top end. And if you're looking for a way of getting out of mana issues, Cultivator's Caravan from Martin Muller will do it. Doesn't even signal to Owen just yet into what other colors he might have to worry about. Malfunction. Gets a little bit of a read there from Martin Muller. It's not just played on creatures. Any artifact will do. And finally, a forest comes from Martin Muller. You can see that Thriving Rhino, a couple of copies of Sage of Shayla's Claim there. He's got a lot of energy for his red-green beatdown deck. Every turn, though, that goes by gives Owen Turtenwald the opportunity to drop a big play. And this pretty much the biggest play in the entire format. Sky Sovereign, Consul's Flagship. There's no creature to crew it just yet, but it's already shot down a Thriving Rhino. And any three-power creature will mean it can start attacking. And once the Sky Sovereign starts attacking, well, games start ending.
That was absolutely a massive turn in tempo there, Tim, taking out that Thriving Rhino. And if Owen has a creature to crew this Sky Sovereign, it's going to be able to take out that Spontaneous Artist as well. And here it comes in for six, taking out Martin Mueller's only board presence, and things are rapidly turning in favor of Owen Turtenwald here.
Yeah, Owen playing a couple of copies of that Wildfast Wingsmith, and I can't help but think that the fact that it's a three-power creature is a big part of that. Being able to crew the Sky Sovereign is just a gigantic thing in this format. The Sky Sovereign, with a little bit of support, my pick for one of the best rares in the format.
Oh, absolutely. Just fits in any deck. Absolutely a windmill slam.
So Sage of Shayla's Claim coming along with a friend. 8 energy all of a sudden for Martin Muller, but each of those 2/2, 2/1s are going to find themselves in a spot of trouble here. And, well, it's just going to be a matter of time before Owen Turtenwald is able to get even more on the board. Starts off with a Metal Spinner's Puzzle Knot. That's going to draw him a card, cost him a life. Even though he's not really a deck that's utilizing a huge amount of black mana, just simply filtering through makes sense when you've got bombs like Sky Sovereign to find.
Yeah, unless Muller can answer the Sky Sovereign, this game is going to be over in a hurry. Muller, I believe, does have a Welding Sparks in his hand. We'll have to take a look in just a moment here. Another card that could help him would be Appetite for the Unnatural, one of Green's best main deck answers to a powerful artifact like that. However, looking at the deck list here, it looks like Martin Muller has left his one copy of Appetite for the Unnatural in his sideboards. That is not going to be an out for him in this game.
Yeah, Furious Reprisal, not quite enough damage to be able to kill the Sky Sovereign. Meanwhile, Welding Sparks from Turtenwald does deal with Pima Outrider, and that means that the attacks from the big flagship will be enough to clear all the creatures off Martin Mueller's board yet again. So Martin Muller down to two just off attacks from Sky Sovereign, and that enough to clean up the game. Very, very straightforward game for Owen Turtenwald there. Number one ranked in the world and wins game one with relative ease. We'll have more magic for you in the feature match area after these messages.
Check out Kaladesh Draft Leagues on Magic Online. Build a deck at your own pace and play at your convenience. Draft anytime, play anytime. For more information, visit mtgo.com.
Optimism, innovation, and the spirit of creativity fill these pages, lavishly illustrated with the award-winning art of Magic the Gathering. Welcome to Kaladesh, a vibrant, beautiful plane where anything is possible. Join the heroic planeswalkers of the Gatewatch as they explore the Inventor's Fair and let your imagination soar alongside thopters and airships crafted by the best artificers in the multiverse.
Hello and welcome back. You will see that as much as our first match, game one, went incredibly quickly, that not an unusual thing here at our feature match in this, the last round of draft of the entire Pro Tour. Every single one of our matches, game one, has already completed. Now, Ian Duke, what does that say to us about what the winning drafters are doing for this format?
Well, I mean, it does indicate a more aggressive slant for the format, and I would agree with you there, Tim, but we actually have seen in the past feature match rounds, rounds one and two of this draft here, we actually saw quite a few blue-based slower control decks working really well, including there were three black-blue control decks in our first draft pod here, piloted by Reed Duke, Shota Yasuoka, and Matteo More, I believe. So we've actually seen quite a spectrum here. I think it just so happens that these matches are off to a pretty fast start.
So we're going to get a chance to have a little bit of a look in on one of our other matches. It's just kicking off there. We have on our second table, Donald Smith's up against Brock Parker. Just kicking off their match now. And we get a chance to see what's going on here. Black-white from Brock Parker, Donald Smith on red-green. And we're actually hearing that this is their game one. They had a deck check, so they're a touch behind the rest of the feature match area. But I'm sure these guys will be able to catch that right back up. We can see a Renegade Freighter coming down for Parker. Obviously, it would have been ideal if he had a creature already available to crew it, but took a turn off to use impeccable timing on Thriving Grubs.
Sorry. It's all good. We have plenty of time.
Yeah. Donald Smith getting stuck in here. And Armorcraft Judge draws an additional card here. Armorcraft Judge, very, very powerful in green-black where there are lots of plus one counters, but pretty solid in any green deck.
Yep, absolutely naturally keying off of things like Fabricate as well as a couple other effects that can add counters to your creatures.
It looks like Parker has plenty of vehicles to work with, a Sky Skiff in hand in addition to the Renegade Express in play, but this turn, he's going to want to find a creature of some sort so that he can start actually sending those vehicles in. Looks like a Thriving Rat's being shuffled to the front there for Brock Parker. It may be that this is going to take a little while to get going. I'm kind of excited to see whether or not we can get a bit more of Muller versus Turtenwald going. So we're going to jump back to that match, but do not worry. We'll bring you updates from some of our other matches. Just so you know, Shota Yasuoka did drop his first game against Matt Nass. Nass able to get aggressive on the huge bomb-laden deck of Yasuoka. We may potentially see a bit of that depending on how the timings of our other games go. But again, we see Inventor's Apprentice from Martin Muller a lot more powerful on the play on turn one than how we saw it on turn two in the first game. And an interesting one here, the gremlin that comes into play for Owen Turtenwald here shows a bit of respect for the artifacts that might be coming from the other side of the table.
Yeah, we did see a Cultivator's Caravan from Martin Muller in game one. And Owen looking like he's got a little bit of a slower, more anemic hand here. Thankfully for him, he does have a Cathartic Reunion to throw away a couple of those lands, hopefully dig into something that can allow him to curve out a little bit better. Owen's deck sporting actually three copies of Cathartic Reunion, which work very well with his Dynavolt Tower that we saw a peek of in his hand last game. Of course, did not hit the battlefield, but I would love to have this be a Dynavolt Tower deck. I mean, Dynavolt Tower game, rather, I should say.
Turtenwald, lots of things going on. It looks like he has been able to draw into his Sky Sovereign on time. And the Ruinous Gremlin he has in play, that is a sideboard card. And actually looking pretty good against what Martin Muller has going on. If he does choose to kill off the one artifact creature that Martin Muller has, then suddenly that Inventor's Apprentice, not looking quite so exciting. A block and a sacrifice there, meaning he takes no damage from that attack. I'm guessing that Owen's going to be pretty happy with that because basically he just wants to buy time until he's able to deploy his gigantic threats.
And was that a pass back from Muller with four lands untapped? So no turn four play, at least on his own turn here. Could be a really good sign from Owen Turtenwald's perspective.
Now, Spark of Creativity, a really interesting card, one that in this instance wasn't even able to deal with Inventor's Apprentice, but it kind of sort of cycles. Talk us through how this one kind of came about, because it's a little bit of a different burn spell for red.
Yeah, it's just kind of a kooky card that we were exploring some more red space there. Red is allowed to do sort of impulsive type card draw, use it or lose it kind of a thing. So this was kind of a twist on melding that style of card draw with some red burn.
But again, Sky Sovereign has come down, dealt with the only creature on Martin Muller's side of the board. This time around, it's not as if he's stuck short on colors of mana, simply only really deploying one threat to the board and Owen Turtenwald's hand well matched up to be able to deal with those threats individually. Elegant Edgecrafters, though, now we have a creature that's actually big enough that it's not going to get killed off by Sky Sovereign, and I'm kind of intrigued to see where that takes us.
Yeah, certainly this game looking a little bit less one-sided than the previous one was.
We say this, and then, of course, Welding Sparks teaming up with Fireforge's Puzzle Knot in order to be able to deal enough damage to deal with what was a 6 toughness creature. 1 damage from the Puzzle Knot, then a full 5 damage from the Welding Sparks thanks to the 2 artifacts in play.
So a nice play there from Owen, and unfortunately for Martin Muller, no play for him on the following turn. Looks like he's flooding out a little bit. Owen's still unable to find a creature so far for his Sky Sovereign, but does add a Dynavolt Tower to the battlefield. So I'm getting my wish here, Tim. This is a Dynavolt Tower game, at least in some respect.
Dynavolt Tower, a card that we saw getting a little bit of play and constructed as well in the hands of Pierre Dargent in the red-blue control decks that just basically turn all of your spells into some proportion of a lightning bolt. Well, Consulate Skygate, it is a creature. It's not a creature that's very effective at crewing a big skyship, but one that is Aetherscroll Ancient. Of course, a 6-6 in and of itself, very good. Getting you extra energy, great with the Dynavolt Tower. And for that first turn, at least, it doesn't mind getting behind the wheel of the skyship.
Who would have thought a sky whale would be crewing a skyship, Tim?
I mean, they kind of look similar. It's almost as if the skyship was designed to look a bit like one of these giant sky whales.
Maybe they're just, you know, engineering thinking ahead there.
Well, again, we do have a creature from Martin Muller that's big enough that it can't get killed by the Sky Sovereign on its own, but I don't think Owen Turtenwald minds simply attacking in with his gigantic flyers here. That enough to end things with the help of Fireforge's Puzzle Knot, and very straightforward 2-0 there for Owen Turtenwald. He's going to be able to go back into the constructed rounds feeling pretty good in spite of having had a bit of a rocky time with the Aetherworks Marvel deck when playing constructed yesterday. So we're going to get a chance to look in on one of our other matches now, one that we've not had a chance to see thus far. We've heard that Matt Nass has just beaten Shota Yasuoka, so Yasuoka's 10 deck, the deck just absolutely chock full of bombs, did get run over there. I can only presume that must have been just more aggression from Matt Nass before Yasuo could really get online. We're going to get a chance to see a different match, though, that one being between Hall of Famer Rafael Levy and Alex Bastecki. Bastecki, the only player in this feature match area that does not currently have a perfect record in this Kaladesh draft format at the Pro Tour level. Raf Levy there, we can see 676 pro points, has played in a crazy 92 Pro Tours. I believe that he has played more Pro Tours than any other Pro Tour player in the history of the game and still playing at absolutely the top level. But right now, he's a game down, does need to fight back, and is currently playing mono red in terms of what he has in play, a second self-assembler. So he's got things to do with mana, but unfortunately, he does not have more than one color of mana in play. And
yeah, I actually took out his deck list to take a look here, Tim, to see if he was indeed playing mono red. He is not. He's actually playing red black. So he's just gotten a little bit of an unfortunate mana draw there, probably with some black cards stranded in his hand.
So Alex Bastecki, he is on white red, just 6 life, and kind of trying to figure out whether or not he can hold the ground here, because as things stand, those two self-assemblers are pretty sizable monsters, and while there's also a sky skiff that can attack in the air, it means that there's a bit of a problem for Bastecki in terms of closing out this game, in spite of the fact that his opponent is very much hampered on mana.
One card a turn.
That's true.
Looks like Bastecki with a couple of good options in terms of what to do at 5 mana. Wayward Giant, the big 4/5 with Menace, or Ballista Charger, a vehicle that effectively doesn't add an additional creature to his board if he wants to go wide, but certainly adds a big creature to the board if he just wants to attack in with big old Rumbler, and of course also triggering Salivating Gremlins in play. So it's now a 4/3 Trampler coming in. And Levy, not just considering the blocks this turn, I would guess, but also what could come in future turns of attacks. Levy's decisions being made a little bit easier here because Alex Bastecki did have to tap out before combat in order to play his big Ballista Charger. Ultimately, he decides to simply take the damage from that Salivating Gremlins hit. Still has not found another color of mana, so now he's kind of firstly lining up potential blocks for next turn before he figures out how he can attack here. Every artifact here doing a little bit of additional damage there thanks to the Reckless Fireweaver that Levy has in play. And that enough actually to set things up for a big swing in. And Raph Levy has managed to get there in spite of the fact that he never found black mana. We're going to get a chance to get a look in on the match between Brock Parker and Donald Smith, that the other match that we have going on here. And that one started a little late, so they're still kind of well in the swing of things here. We're going to get a chance to jump back down and see exactly how they're going. Brock Parker, of course, was very, very successful back on the Pro Tour back in the day. It's been a little while since we've last seen him at the top tables in the feature match area, but of course, very happy to have him back. And it looks like here he's got, well, that rather epic-looking foil there, I believe, is a Thriving Rat, joined by 3 servos and Weapon Craft Enthusiast for the black-white deck of Parker. Filigree Familiar alongside Spontaneous Artist, and, well, there's a Fairground Trumpeter there that right now is just a 2-2, but if Donald Smith can find a way of putting +1/+1 counters on any of his creatures, like, for example, that Kuzhar Seedsmith, then he will get extra counters on his Trumpeter end of turn also. I like this attack from Filigree Familiar here because, effectively, as a 3-3 now, it is threatening Brock Parker's life total, but also, if it dies, he gets to draw a card, which is not exactly the worst deal. Whole lot of blocks there. Donald Smith gets to draw a card, and having killed off a little bit, just finds a land. Now, this is still the first game. These guys starting a little later than much of the rest of the beach match area.
Things certainly looking good as the board stands for Donald Smith.
Yeah, not a huge amount of power available to Brock Parker here. Basically, the Weaponcraft Enthusiast, now that it's in play, it's kind of done its best work. and no plus one counters there for the Aetherborn Marauder to take hold of. But a 2-2 flyer with lifelink, still, you know, a very relevant body on a lot of boards, and this one's no exception.
That's right, Tim. Both players low on life total, and Brock does have a few chump blockers available on his side. So, you know, we could see a race-type scenario being set up here over the course of a couple turns where Brock tries to just chip away with that lifelinker, throw some blockers in the way, and kind of hold things off until he can win in the air.
Looks like Donald Smith does not want to wait around for that, though. Puts a plus one counter on his Spontaneous Artist with Hunt the Weak, takes out the one flyer. Yes, Brock Parker gets to gain a couple of life in that fight, but at the same time, it means that the biggest threat on Brock Parker's side of the board has gone away. Now Smith does attack in with his creatures here. There is already two damage on that Spontaneous Artist, right? So this is a little risky. The Fairgrounds Trumpeter is going to trigger at the end of turn again because a plus one counter has gone onto a creature. Parker chooses to trade off his servos for the Spontaneous Artist, but drops to five on that swing, and the Trumpeter now a 4-4. So there's a lethal amount of damage on the board for Donald Smith, and Brock Parker's going to have to find something here in order to stay in this game. Looks like there's a few lands in Brock Parker's hand, but at least one spell to work with. Parker, one of the players that Owen Turtenwald credited in his Hall of Fame induction speech as a big influence on him as a player and a person, and I'm sure he'll be happy to see his friend in the feature match area here. Parker taking another hit here, and Renegade Freighter, not something he wanted to see, has to scoop them up for game one. Donald Smith takes that. We're going to get a chance to jump back and see a little bit more of Levy versus Bestecki, and it looks like these players just checking out their opening hands, figuring out if they're good enough. We've already seen Levy winning a game without ever drawing his second color of mana, so we know that there's some power there, and it looks like Levy just figuring out the details of what he wants to be doing. Renegade Freighter in hand there alongside a few other bits and pieces, but it's Bestecki kicking things off, having lost the second game. Ruinous Gremlin, the first play for Levy here, respecting that they could be powerful artifacts. Ninth Bridge Patrol from Alex Bestecki. That one takes a bit of work to get going. In some respects, it feels kind of like an unruly mob, but does a little bit more in this format, Ian.
That's right. If you have any ways of, you know, blinking your creatures or returning to your hand, it's like an unruly mob that also triggers on other ways of creatures leaving the battlefield besides just dying.
And looking at Alex Bestecki's hand, he's got some power in there, but it all costs about five, and that's pretty good for Raphael Levy if he can get some threats on the board earlier. Harness Lightning, a fine removal spell, but the Renegade Freighter kind of stranded until he finds a good creature, and Raphael Levy with Harness Lightning does not want that to let that happen. There's Renegade Freighter for Levy. Self-Assembler is still in hand for him.
So given that Levy has the Self-Assembler here and plenty of lands, I have to like the way that this game is shaping up for him. Both of these decks, you know, the color combinations are usually aggressive, but Levy appearing kind of more well-suited for a longer game here. On the other hand, Bestecki, a couple copies of Wayward Giant and Multiform Wonder in his hand, has some five drops of his own to fight back.
Yeah, uncharacteristically, this particular game showing off the top end of the curves rather than the bottom. And I guess the worry for both these players at this point is how good are your top decks going to be when there's already a bunch of five drops in play?
That's right. I have to wonder if these players actually sideboarded a little bit farther up the curve to try to go one step slower and more powerful than their opponent, which is a classic way to navigate more aggressive semi-mirror matches. And in particular here, the Wayward Giants looking like they're going to match up very well against Raph Levy's self-assemblers.
Renegade Freighter, of course, is big enough to rumble against a Wayward Giant. They would trade off. And it looks like, given that Bestecki knows that he has another giant still to come, quite happy to make that trade. Raph Levy getting to do double duty with his self-assembler here. First up, fetching another copy. But there's also that Quicksmith Genius in play, so he's going to get a chance to get a loot, or a rummage, I suppose you call it, for having an artifact come into play.
And an interesting trade there of the Renegade Freighter for the Wayward Giant, kind of for both players' perspectives. I'm sure Bisteki was just holding his breath, hoping that Raflevi didn't have a combat trick like a Built to Smash or something along those lines. Raflevi, on the other hand, probably hoping for the trade there so now he can get his self-assemblers going post-combat and not have to worry about a 4 or 5 representing a block there. But as we do know, Bisteki having a second copy of Wayward Giant, that exchange probably going to favor him a little bit.
Yeah, still Multiform Wonder to come. And I kind of like the fact that Bisteki is hanging back on the big rare. I mean, in practical terms, in some respects, it's just not as good as a Wayward Giant when you've got a 4-4 on the other side of the battlefield. But also, it gives time for Raflevi to play out a bit of removal before he deploys the big rare. Sky Skiff and Foundry Screecher coming down. So it looks like Levy now looking to go to the air. That Foundry Screecher already a 3-1. Raflevi there, cool as a cucumber. He's been in this sort of situation plenty of times before. Sees the Multiform Wonder coming from Alex Bisteki. Three energy coming along with it. Revoke Privileges was the pickup for Bisteki, and that one could be pretty relevant in this this race because it's the kind of removal that you really want to be playing while you're also doing other things, right, Ian?
Absolutely true. I mean, Bisteki a little bit clogged in terms of the mana he has there. Was probably considering playing the Multiform Wonder versus playing both of the other spells in his hand, the Revoke Privileges as well as the Aviary Mechanic. But I like getting the Multiform Wonder on the battlefield here. I imagine we'll see that Revoke Privileges probably go on the Foundry Screecher, and that'll allow the Multiform Wonder a little bit of kind of wiggle room to get in the air, maybe get some lifelink going, maybe spending some energy to get some extra damage. So tons of options here for Alex Bisteki, but Raflevi looking like he has the stronger board overall, especially consider, you know, the cards he has in his hand and that second copy of Self-Assembler here. But still a very close game for sure. I think things a little bit in the favor of Raflevi right now.
Well, we know that there's another Self-Assembler coming along. We saw it fetched out last turn, so it's not going to be a surprise to Alex Bisteki either. And with the number of lands that he has available, it's the most mana-efficient play also. There we see the Quicksmith Genius allowing a loot from Raphael Levy, or a rummage, I guess, when the artifact comes into play. Thriving Rat's not so good right this moment.
Multiform Wonder effectively holding off both of Raphael Levy's flyers there with its ability to go to the air and adjust its power and toughness. But have to keep in mind that Alex Bisteki, having a pretty limited supply of energy here, his deck doesn't look too good at producing a lot of energy. So we may reach a point in the game where, you know, Raf just allows that Multiform Wonder to get a little bit of value, but then kind of drains away the rest of Alex's energy and, you know, tries to punch in through the air, for example.
Fireforge's Puzzle Knot for Levy means that he does have a little bit of burn available. While it's kind of expensive to use it as a Chandra's Pyrohelix, you know, you've got to be ready to do that, and I think that there may be a case for him to at least consider at some point fairly soon as Bastion Mastodon comes down and the creatures on Alex Bisteki's side of the board just matching up really well against what Raf has going on.
Yeah, that is true, except for the fact that we know that Raf has that Fire Forger's Puzzle Knot. So what's really important about that is Raphael Levy has two self-assemblers, both four-power creatures, and all three of Alex Bisteki's creatures are able to go either have five toughness or able to go up to five toughness in the case of Multiform Wonder. So, you know, Raf has to think about, could he craft an attack here where Alex sets up a couple blocks, matching up four fives versus four fours, for example, and then post-combat brings out that Fire Forger's Puzzle Knot and takes out the blockers.
It's a nice line of play. Let's see whether or not Levy wants to be making that trade. Lawless Broker, an interesting one, because that's a creature that Alex Pastecchi really does not want to die on this board. The 4/4s that are in play don't look terribly exciting, but if either of them becomes a 5/5, then it matches up very, very well against what he has going on. There we see the Broker. I mean, it's kind of just a body while it's on the board, but the fact that when it dies, it puts a +1/+1 counter on a creature that you control on a board like this is very relevant. There hasn't exactly been a great time to deploy this Aviary mechanic yet for Alex Pastecchi. It's one of those cards that if you've got great coming into play abilities, it can feel fantastic. Also, if you find yourself on the wrong side of a malfunction or a revoke privileges. But right now, it's just sat in his hand waiting for a good opportunity to get used.
Yeah, I mean, one potential application is to bounce the multiform wonder back to Alex Pastecchi's hand and replay it to kind of refill on energy here. It's possible we see that post-combat, but in the meantime, Alex attacking with the multiform wonder. I believe it has flying already. So a 3/3 flying coming through that can either gain lifelink or become a 5/1 or potentially become a 1/5 if it's blocked.
I've always thought of multiform wonder as being the sort of the latest iteration of the likes of Urza's Avenger back from the early days of Magic, a creature that can gradually gain all sorts of different abilities.
Go up 3 energy.
And exactly as he called it. It gets cast. The Aviary mechanic gets cast to return the multiform wonder, going a little bit ahead on energy, effectively getting a vigilant flying attack in there as well. Levy dropping to 17 there.
Looks like Levy, considering that attack that I mentioned earlier, where you can send in one or both of the self-assemblers, and if they are blocked by 5 toughness creatures, Fireforger's Puzzle Knot can come down after combat to clean up.
And with that Quicksmith Genius in play, even more value being got out of the Fireforger's Puzzle Knot as and when it comes into play, as Levy choosing to keep an additional mountain in hand, which is a fine card to discard at this point. He doesn't necessarily need much more in the way of red mana. Sure. Alex Pastecchi knows that there's something up and chooses to double block one of the self-assemblers. Now, talk us through why that may be, Ian.
I think he's just really thinking about a combat trick like Built to Smash, for example. And just want to make sure that even if a combat trick is used, that he'll still get value out of the trade. But I think Raph is perfectly happy with that exchange there. All he wanted to do was be able to deal 4 damage to one of the 4 or 5 creatures, and was still able to do that despite the double block. So half of a Fireforger's Puzzle Knot plus a self-assembler trading for the Bastion Mastodon. A good trade for Raph Levy.
And Levy getting a bit of damage in as well, certainly not worth nothing. Sooner or later, he does need to reduce Alex Pastecchi down to 0. Follows things up there with the Spyside Infiltrator. When it gets tapped, it's going to deal 1 damage to Alex Pastecchi, kind of an honorary pilot. Sky Skiff in play means that there will be a source of damage that Raphael Levy can present that does not involve him actually getting into the red zone. Pastecchi has picked up another removal spell, though. Alongside Revoke Privileges, he now has Welding Sparks and a plethora of targets on Raph Levy's side of the board for him if he chooses to fire it off.
Sparks this creature.
It's a dead bend, I think. Sure, dead bend.
So Welding Sparks on the Foundry's creature. Raph says, it's a dead bat.
Levy, one thing that he's been able to do very well this game is make the most of that Quicksmith genius. He's just gradually been making sure that the cards that he's drawing are always quality spells, getting rid of perhaps surplus lands, that sort of thing, with each and every artifact that he plays. Meanwhile, Alex Bestecki, he's got one card left in hand. I mean, it's a good one, but perhaps a little bit heavier on land. He does need to hope that he draws into a glut of spells from here on in, or otherwise he may find himself on the wrong side of things.
And that good one, as you mentioned there, Tim, of course, is Revoke Privileges, which Bestecki's been holding on to patiently for quite a while here, just trying to use his creatures on board to deal with Raphael Levy's threats and saving that removal spell for an emergency situation. But actually, here we go. So this is, again, kind of a more tempo-oriented type thing, shoring up the ground, making sure Raph isn't able to punch through as Raphael Levy's board does develop, kind of going wide.
Yep.
So Self-Assembler no longer has any privileges whatsoever, but there will be at least a Carter Club bouncer coming along to follow things up here. Looks like an Aether Torch Renegade, the draw for Raphael Levy here. He's already got one energy. This not a board where a one-point pinger looks immediately exciting, but at least it does mean that multi-form wonder is not going to be tempted to go up to being a 5-1 anytime soon. As is frequently the case in these sorts of games, the air ends up being an important battlefield for each of these players. Skyskiff against Multiform Wonder, but the Multiform Wonder is going to run out of gas at some point, whereas Raph Levy's Skyskiff has plenty of creatures to crew it. And it was the Picard's Club bouncer that came along, so Aether Torch Renegade, the final card in Levy's hand. If he can gain just a little bit more energy, its second ability to pay 8 energy to deal 6 to an opponent could become a fairly big deal here. Eddie Charles Hawker, nice pickup though for Alex Bestecki. 2 energy gained, and it's going to be able to give one of his creatures flying when it attacks. And I don't know, something like that Wayward Giant, menace plus flying essentially is unblockability in this sort of a circumstance. Alternatively, it's just more fuel for this Multiform Wonder.
Yeah, it seems to me like Alex really wants to keep using that Multiform Wonder to get in lifelink damage, I think is where he's at right now. Raphael Levy with the Skyskiff plus Spireside Infiltrator is able to just kind of chip away for damage here and there, and I think Alex wants to make sure that he's scooping up as much life as he can before something happens to the Multiform Wonder or before Raph, you know, draws some way to force through extra damage.
And that was basically the last window that Alex had in order to get in a 5-point swing rather than a 3-point swing. Levy tapped low enough that Fireforge's Puzzle not an option. And indeed, of course, the Skyskiff having swung in already. Each of these players on 7 and 3, one other thing for them to consider, neither of them had a spectacular run when it came to their constructed, though obviously still in the fighting the good fight. If it works out that they lose in this round, then basically they do not need to be worrying too much about playing on Sunday. So the constructed rounds will clearly be a sweat, but equally, this limited round, very important for both of these players. See Raph Levy doing, I like to call it visual math, kind of figuring out where the attacks and blocks might be, doing a little bit of math to himself in French, just figuring out exactly how both this turn and probably the attacks from Alex Bestecki are going to go next turn. With no cards in hand, I think it's reasonable to assume that the board's not going to change a crazy amount come the following turn.
Yeah, the trouble for Raphael Levy here is that Wayward Giant. on the side of Alex Bestecky, just representing a huge 4-5 blocker. And I think what Raphael's thinking here is it worth just brute forcing my way through that blocker, sending in, you know, as many creatures as I can, just accepting that one is going to die to the giant and getting through some damage, and then hoping to chain that into, you know, maybe a 2 or 3 turn sequence where I'm putting together a lethal amount of damage. Decides not to make an attack here, I think, and instead just plays the Aether Torch Renegade, gathering up some energy, adding to his ability to ping on board here. He does have that Fire Forger's Puzzle Knot as well, so two pings he'll be capable of starting next turn. And he may want to play that land from his hand just so he has that ability to activate the Fire Forger's Puzzle Knot if, for example, Alex Bestecky tries to get in with the Multiform Wonder again and pump it up to 5 power, 1 toughness.
Yeah, it's kind of a big decision point for him, actually, because the alternative would be to hold it back for the Quicksmith Genius. Ultimately, he does choose to put it into play. So this way round, both these players working with empty hands, Alex Bestecky just picking up for the turn. And how much does it change your decision trees when you know that your opponent can't possibly have any tricks?
It's from Alex's standpoint, you mean, Tim?
Yeah, I guess in this case.
It certainly simplifies some decisions for sure. I mean, in this case, the trick that was opened up there for Raphael Levy is the onboard trick of being able to activate the Fire Forger's Puzzle Knot. So now Alex needs to be thinking and knowing that he can't, you know, for example, pump his Multiform Wonder up to a 5-1 this turn, even if he does find extra ways to generate energy. But it looks like Alex just picking up a land. Doesn't really look like there are any great attacks for him here. He can spend the energy to give the Multiform Wonder flying and attack in, but then if the Sky Skiff blocks, it doesn't really leave him with too many great options there, because, you know, Raphael Levy can ping with the Fire Forger's Puzzle Knot, and then, you know, Alex can respond back by spending the second energy to make the Multiform Wonder into a 1-5, but then hasn't really gotten him anywhere. So I'm not really seeing any great attacks for Alex here, and he may just have to pass the turn back. Considering the Multiform Wonder.
Go, take one.
Quick update for you on the other match that we have still going on. Brock Parker is up against Donald Smith, and they are going to be going to a game 3. Brock Parker able to square things up there. So still more action going on in our feature match area. Depending on exactly how this game goes, we may get a chance to jump in on that one and see the conclusion.
So now Raphael Levy, I think considering getting in with the Sky Skiff, again, with only 2 energy for Alex Bestecky, if he gives the Multiform Wonder flying and blocks with the 3-3, then, you know, Raphael Levy is threatening pinging the Multiform Wonder. That forces Alex to make the Multiform Wonder a 1-5, using up all his energy. But instead, it looks like Raphael decides to use the Fire Forger's Puzzle Knot as well as the ping from the Aether Torch Renegade to take out that Eddie Trailhawk. And remember that every turn that goes by, Raphael is able to ping for 1 with the Spireside Infiltrator by crewing Sky Skiff.
It's not a fast clock, but it is a clock counting down Alex Bestecky. And of course, the clock also counting down on the round. These players, they've got a bit of time yet to go. We did have some blisteringly fast games initially, but it's still a consideration. Neither of these players looking to pick up an unintentional draw if they can help it. World Fast Monitor was the pickup there for Bestecky, which means that he is going to be able to add something to his board. All that Raph found was a swamp that is currently sat in his hand. Playing.
So now we see Alex attacking with the Multiform Wonder. He didn't do it last turn. The reason he is able to this turn is now the Fire Forger's Puzzle Knot is gone and the Aether Torch Renegade is tapped. So there's no ping capability for Raphael Levy. And Alex taking advantage of that and getting in for, I think, three points of damage there. Did not use the second energy to gain lifelink of note, instead going for Raph's life total.
Yeah, not so much energy production as you previously mentioned, Ian, and that means that Bestecky needs to choose his spots fairly carefully in terms of these final points of energy, because once Multiform Wonder is just a 3-3, it's suddenly one of the less impressive creatures on this battlefield. So Rush of Vitality was the draw for Raphael Levy here, and that's a big card in terms of changing the way that a race goes. Looks like he's being patient on it for now, but sooner or later it could be a big one. And actually, talking about big draws, I think that Alex Bezdecky has found one of the more important ones for him as this game goes late. That is Dapala, Pilot Exemplar. Now, Dapala, when you've got mana available, does an awful lot. Here she is. There we get a look at her. Immediately giving other dwarves +1/+1. You know what? Avery Mechanic is a dwarf. Each vehicle also getting +1/+1 as long as it's a creature. And when Dapala becomes tapped, you can pay X. There's a lot of mana available for Alex Bezdecky here. And look at reveal the top X cards of your library. Get all of the dwarves and all of the vehicles that you find into your hand. There's no selection there, just every single one of them. Now, depending on the exact nature of what's left in Alex Bezdecky's deck at this point in the game, we could see him tapping fairly low and drawing quite a few cards with that on the attack. Obviously, the ideal would be to use Dapala, Pilot Exemplar, as a pilot for a vehicle, because that way you're not even exposing the legend to being blocked. Right now, that's not an option for Bezdecky.
Go ahead.
Spyside Infiltrator, the draw for Alex Bezdecky. Now, currently, again, without a vehicle, his Infiltrator would not look as good as the one that Levy has going on. Levy's merrily pinging in for a point of damage by crewing each and every turn cycle.
And as you briefly mentioned earlier, Tim, another huge development in this game is that copy of Rush of Vitality that's in Raphael Levy's hand. You know, we've seen Alex Bezdecky taking an approach where he's trying to chip in for damage whenever he can and get Raphael Levy's life total low. And up until, you know, last turn, that plan seemed like a viable win condition for Alex Bezdecky. But if that Rush of Vitality comes out when Alex is not expecting it, that could really, really swing the life totals in favor of Raphael Levy.
Now, Hijack was the pickup for Levy here. That means that he's going to be able to take control of an artifact or creature until the end of turn. And he has three energy still, so if he took hold of that multiform wonder, he could do some big plays with it, including and not limited to attacking with it and then killing it off after combat using his additional energy.
Yeah, fantastic point, Tim, and I think we may actually see that come out here. In fact, if I'm counting everything up, Raphael Levy may have 9 points of damage here as long as Alex does not have anything here. So what I'm counting up here is multiform wonder attacking for 5 in the air, Sky Skiff is 2/+1 from Spireside Infiltrator.
Now, one thing that Bezdecky can do is he could spend one energy now to make that multiform wonder into a 1/5. That would at least mean that in terms of the energy available to Raph Levy, he's not going to be able to do things quite as efficiently as he might otherwise like and actually kill it off. Huge draw here for Raphael Levy. Hijack, one of those cards that looks very, very similar to Active Treason. It's got an extra red in the cost, but it can gain control of artifacts that are not creatures.
I'll make it a 1/5.
Okay.
Bezdecky does make it a 1/5 before passing it across.
So a nice heads-up play there, but you know what he was not considering there is the Rush of Vitality actually adds, I believe, the 9th point of damage here, as I was counting up earlier. So again, 5 from Multiform Wonder, 3 from the Sky Skiff plus the Infiltrator crewing it, and then another additional one from the Rush of Vitality. So if there are no tricks here from Alex, I believe.
I'll make this guy fly and say you take one.
That is okay. It's with the trigger was on the stack. Your opponent mentioned it before taking a next game action. While he was stepping it, the game action would be attack. So I believe this was on time.
So the player is just clarifying with the judge whether, you know, there's a little bit of out-of-order sequencing, which is allowed in tournament magic. You know, if you say a couple things all happening at once, even if you don't get the order quite correct, as long as you point them all out, they do all get to happen there. And the key trigger there was the one damage from the Spireside Infiltrator.
Do you have any blocks?
I mean, Raph does need to make sure he actually spends the energy to make the Melsum Wonder, makes the Multiform Wonder fly. It looks like he's actually choosing not to make it fly here. So Levy with a big, big turn here. No blocks at all from Alex Bastecki, and you saw the little reaction there from Rafael Levy. So each of these players kind of threatening that there's a few extra bits and pieces going on. Looks like first up we have a pump of the power and a reduction of the toughness of that multiform wonder.
Now, do we know if Bastecki has anything in hand that can disrupt this attack from Levy? Looks like just the planes, we think. So I'm a bit confused here. I mean, what we're seeing here is both creatures being unblocked. Bastecki at 8, multiform wonder representing 5 damage, Skyskiff representing 2. That would be 7. I think if Raf goes for the rush of vitality here, that will be the game, unless I'm missing something, Tim.
I mean, even if he doesn't, he still has Skyskiff and Spice Isle Infiltrator for the 1 point next turn. I guess part of this calculation from Alex Bastecki is, can I get the necessary damage in to win next turn if I don't block?
What's my life? 6?
You're at 6.
And that may be the case, Tim. It may be that since Alex doesn't know about the rush of vitality in Rafael Levy's hand, he's counting on just taking 6 damage here and thinking about, you know, my best chance to win is just to take the 7 and attack back next turn. And then Rafael, in turn, is thinking about, you know, do I have to go for the win right now? What happens if Alex has, you know, a trick or a removal spell or something in response? And
I mean, I guess there's also, he's got 1 energy left. If things are not going to work out, does he want to spend that energy on killing off the multiform wonder? Does he want to spend it on lifelink for the multiform wonder so that he's a little bit safer on these swings back? There's quite a lot of options considering what he's got going on here. Here, Raf Levy there saying, if you've got this card, I'm probably dead.
Oh, not what yet, but if you have nothing, then you're dead. On something that attacks. I just don't know which one.
So, Rush of Vitality. Raf Levy says, I'm going to play it on one of my attackers. I'm just going to figure out which. If you don't have anything, you're definitely dead. And credit to Alex Bastecki here. He's not giving anything away. He's going to let Raf make his decision before basically extending the hand here, as far as we can tell.
On this guy.
And there is the handshake. Raf Levy gets it. You hear the rounds of applause. I'm sure that many of Raf's teammates watching just from behind the bleachers there. And we will get a chance to see just a little bit more magic in our final match in the feature match area. And Brock Parker, well, we've heard that he's in a dicey spot on just 2 life here in the final match going on in our feature match area. Not had exactly the draw that he would want here. 18 life for Donald Smith, who has not got very many lands, but appears to have been able to get quite a lot done with a Renegade Freighter that's only just been dealt with.
2 cards in hand.
There we can see Brock Parker. 1 Pro Tour top 8, but he made it count. 37 Pro Tours in total. And ultimately just has to extend the hand. Midnight Oil in hand, which at some point might have drawn him into something, but he just did not have enough threats to be able to make things happen there. So Donald Smith on his red-green deck advances to 3-0 in the draft, and that being 9-2 overall in the tournament. Fantastic performance from him. And we've got a few players that have ended up undefeated in this draft format. Owen Turtenwald, our newly inducted Hall of Famer and indeed Player of the Year for last year, he went undefeated. Matt Nass went undefeated in draft at this Pro Tour. And of course, Donald Smith that we saw there. Now, it's obviously very, very early in the season to start thinking about the likes of the Draft Master and all that sort of thing. But it is a consideration. Obviously, right now, they're just happy to have won a whole ton of matches at the Pro Tour and be in great shape to do good things, but it's still a big deal.
That's right. That's the beautiful thing about going for Draft Masters. You're just trying to do what you were doing anyway, which is win each individual round of Magic as you come to it.
But that is the end of our limited rounds. Join us soon enough for Constructed, but to find out everything else that's been going on this round, we're going to head back to the news desk.
It's the Two Wise Men and me, your host, Rich Hagan, here at the news desk. Brian David Marshall, Louis Scott Vargas, and me. Welcome along to your lunchtime entertainment. You see, there's 21 matches left in the round. The players are going to have a little lunch break as well, but there is a ton of great stuff coming your way. We're going to review the limited action, look at the top pods, see who emerged victorious from those. Then we'll go to Seattle. We'll take you inside R&D for all the people who make the new Magic set for Kaladesh. Then it will be part two of Enter the Battlefield. Now, if you saw this yesterday, we went to Roanoke. This is Sean Kornhauser and Nate Holt, the team behind Walking the Plains and the documentary that's available on Netflix and YouTube, Enter the Battlefield. This is the series, and it's the start of a great new project for two super talented filmmakers. Can't wait to show you part two of that. And then Luis will be here to mark your card for the second afternoon of Standard. But first, gentlemen, Limited is now done.
It's not done. There's still somehow 21 matches going after time has been called in the round.
Well, these are the green-blue mirror matches, right?
Yeah, and on day two, people get a little bit more deliberate. I have noticed that.
Have you really?
Yeah.
Was that something that you knew when you were a player, or is this a whole new coverage land?
Well,
discovery?
I knew when I was a player. It just didn't affect me very much. I was done in 7 minutes anyway.
Well, there we go.
One way or the other.
One way or the other. I'm not even saying I was winning.
Okay, so why don't we take a look at how the pods panned out here on day two. Remember, eight people come in to each group. Here was our pod one. It was our top table, of course it was. And Shota Yasuoki, you see there, and his result not quite in. We know that he fell to 10-1, and we know that Matt Nass went up to 10-1. All the other results are in. So Dajon 9-2, Matteo More. I think Matteo More, BDM, will be very, very happy to have emerged from this one. Started 7-1, comes out at 9-2. A 2-1 in that pod's terrific.
Yeah, no, I spoke to him about it actually. He was thrilled. He was thrilled. You know, he didn't feel like he had maybe the best deck, but you know, was really happy to get a couple wins and to sort of head back into Standard, where he really likes his 8 to work Marvel deck and thinks maybe he got his unluckiness out of his system against Eric Froelich in that last round yesterday. He would love another shot at that matchup.
Oh, yeah. I was in the booth for that round, and he was like, cathartic reunion, discarding 2 Eldrazi, draw 3 more Eldrazi. Like, all right.
Luis, you were at the wall with Reed Duke going through the draft viewer. He ended up 1-2. He had, 5 is the maximum number of colors you can play in Magic right now, and that's kind of what he did. He had all sorts of things going on.
Yeah, he was really a 3-color deck. He was a blue, black, splashing Dovin Bond, but he had off-color activated abilities that were both red and green, thanks to either hub.
Yeah, so it was a strange one, and I don't know. I mean, obviously you're disappointed at 1-2, but it didn't look like a deck that was particularly built to 3-0.
Yeah,
it had some powerful cards. It had Marionette Master and Saheeli's Artistry, but he ran into Shota Yasuoki, who had the most powerful deck just about you can imagine, but that wasn't a battle Reed was really equipped to fight.
Fair.
All right. What's disappointing is 0-3 in that draft pod, by the way. Eric Froelich cannot wait to get back to Standard here.
Oh, yeah. He ended up, despite his also white-green splashing Whirl of Virtuoso deck, just did not pan out.
Yeah, there's an interesting, that's half of a storyline with Owen Turtenwald. We'll come back to that in a little bit. Let's take a look at our second draft pod then and how this panned out here on day two. So these were players mostly at 7-1, which means that Makis Matsoukas of Greece, he's playing in his very first Pro Tour. Fantastic job by him. He was a beneficiary of a Magic Online RPTQ, and the Greek player aced the pod. He is at 10-1. He's one of your co-leaders. just behind him, Corey Baumeister, Li Shichan, and Rob Pisano, who you talked to BDM earlier on. The loser at this table was Tom Martel. He would be very disappointed to end up 7-4. Valentin Mackel with that draw, still technically alive for top eight, because 12-3-1 may not be enough. We think maybe 13-3 may be where you actually need to be, but still notionally alive.
Yeah. Corey Baumeister, by the way, very excited to be 9-2, but not as excited as Brad Nelson is for him to be 9-2. His brother, like, just as soon as he's done with his match, comes running over the rail to find out wherever his brother is. Watch him. Very excited about how well his brother's doing and how much he's matured since the last time he was on, really playing regularly on the Pro Tour, and how seriously he's taking this his preparation for this tournament.
For sure. Let's take a look at pod number three then for you, and we'll see how that panned out here on day two at Pro Tour Kaladesh. And those top two names went at it in the last round. It was such a stacked pod. In a way, this has gone to form because the four big names are on top of that group of eight. Though Eduardo dos Santos Fieri, you'll know him as Lisho on Magic Online. But Rich Hone beat Palavid Domodorosa in the last round to claim the pod. And Hone is now at 9-1-1. And his name often goes with Mike Crone, of the Philippines / Canada, the Pro Tour Geneva champion from 2007. Mike Roan is still very much alive in this tournament at 8-3. Let's move on to pod number four, if we can, and show you what went on there. Fewer huge names here. Antonino De Rose, you see at 7-4, probably out of the running now. Ludvig Londos of Sweden is there. And BDM, nice to see Adam Jansen still very much alive.
Absolutely, although Adam Jansen just lost this round. I got a chance to watch him lose to Jason Smith. Double Saheeli's artistry for Jason Smith, copying Gonti, copying just like, you know, various, you know, artifact creatures, and it was kind of brutal. Not three noxious gear hulks.
Double noxious gear.
Yeah, nothing like that. But it was still really good, and getting extra cards with copies of Gonti. So pretty ridiculous, that card.
Fantastic stuff. All right, so those were the top four pods as we came in. Now it's all back in the mix because it's no longer playing within your table of eight. Now it is just how everyone goes on the same record. You can play each other again now back in Constructed. We have five rounds to go, plenty more from Luis and the team as we head towards the end of lunch. But right now we're going to send you away from here, and we're going to send you to Seattle, the home, of course, of Wizards of the Coast. Yesterday we showed you part one of Inside R&D, so my fabulous math skills tell me it must be time for part two.
Kaladesh is an amazing place, but any magic setting is only as good as the characters and the stories that live and breathe there. Thankfully, Kaladesh has plenty of friends and foes, old and new, waiting for us. Let's meet them.
When we open on Kaladesh, we're in the middle of an inventor's fair, and this is a grand exhibition of all of the greatest inventions that everybody on the whole world just flocks to this inventor's fair. You bring your, like, the most amazing thing that you've ever made with the hopes of, you know, showing everybody what you've made, of attracting attention of the judges, of the exhibitors, of the people, like, this is the next cool thing for Kaladesh.
So one of the things that premieres in Kaladesh is the story spotlight. I mean, we've since Battle for Zendikar, we've been doing these on-card story beats, but now we're marking them. Like, if you actually look at the bottom of the card, it says, you know, 1 of 5 or whatever. So one of the challenges is, part of design is we work closely with the creative team, and they say, here are creative things we need. In the past, it's like, here's a planeswalker, here's a, you know, legendary creature, or here's a location, here's things that you need to match. But now, we have to match moments in the story, which is a little bit different, because it's more, in the past they said, here are nouns, and now they're like, here are verbs. Match these verbs, please. And it's a very different animal. Trying to match the stories is we want to be true to what the story is, but we want to make fun cards that play well.
Story spotlight number two, captured by the consulate. So Chandra and Liliana are pursuing this renegade threat through the fair. They think they've found someone sort of being shady in the shadows. They go ahead, they're like, oh, we're gonna get this guy, pounce. Yes, it's Tezzeret. This is the, Liliana's like, this, yes, this must be the renegade threat. This must be the threat. Tezzeret is no good. Tezzeret says, no, I am the head judge of this fair. This is my fair. I am chasing another renegade. Gasp, it is Pia Nalar, Chandra's mom. Chandra thought Pia was dead, Pia thought Chandra was dead. This could be this amazing, heartfelt reunion moment. Not so fast, says Tezzeret. This is a renegade. She was planning some destruction here. This is my fair. He has her taken by consulate guard. Chandra has to be held back from trying to save her mom. And so Pia is captured by the consulate.
Deadlock Trap, the artifact, actually shows when Chandra and Nyssa are imprisoned by the consulate as well. Consulate have this secret prison known as the Dund, and Chandra and Nyssa are locked away here.
Deadlock Trap is a story moment card that represents sort of the heroes of the story taken prisoner and locked away in this trap. I believe there's sort of poison gas filling the chamber and they have to figure out how to escape. So pretty cool moment there. This is a card that's meant to reward you for playing lots of energy in your deck. It's sort of an icy manipulator type variant that can tap a creature every turn or lock down a planeswalker, but it costs energy to do so. So in theory, eventually you'll run out of energy, but if you've constructed your deck properly, you can do this turn after turn for quite some time.
That may seem like a fine limited card, but it actually also saw a lot of play in the Future League, especially dealing with large vehicles and giant monsters, so expect to see it at the top tables everywhere.
When things seem at their worst, when Chandra and Nyssa are locked away in the Dund, they are rescued by a stranger. This stranger ends up being a beloved character we haven't seen in some time, and this is a Johnny Goldmane. You see him on the card, impeccable timing, and in the story it is exactly that. But he has been tracking Tezzeret for his own reasons for some time.
Story spotlight number 4 is Fateful Showdown. So Tezzeret has sponsored a grand exhibition at the fair, and he says, based on this long-standing tradition on Kaladesh, we're going to have two inventors face off, and it's going to be sort of like this inventor's duel. And it's going to be him, the head judge, the consulate, versus Pia Nalar, the renegade threat. And he's painted her in this terrible light, and they're going to face off. And Chandra is going to be there to rescue her mom in her mind. And the Gatewatch are going to be there just to make sure she doesn't go crazy and watch out for Tezzeret. The duel starts to get real. Tezzeret starts to throw real magic. Chandra rushes in to protect her mom, fire blazing, and the Gatewatch are like, okay, here we go too. They rush in to help Chandra out. They stop Tezzeret and escape with Pia. They think this is a victory. Chandra and her mom finally get that heartwarming, heartfelt reunion that they've been waiting for, only to find that they have been duped again. Tezzeret had set this all up to cover up his other plan. What he wanted was all of the inventions. What he got was everybody distracted. He had all of his minions collect the inventions, reroute the aether, get it all out, and now he has everything he wanted. They might have Pia, but he doesn't care at this point.
This is really Chandra's story in a lot of ways. This is her homecoming, but to a world that she's very at odds with. I mean, she's a pyromancer and isn't this inventor. So she's not really... She is at odds with the world that she's in. But because this is her story, I really wanted to make sure we were doing something spectacular with her. So we deployed the 4 abilities, which really gives you lots of ability to do really fine control. You do something different one game to the next, one turn to the next. I'm really excited about this Chandra because she just has so much possibility.
First of all, she can just exile the top card of the library. You get to cast it, you get to deal some damage to them potentially, everything a red deck could want. You need cards, you get cards. You need damage, you get damage. She can give you mana so you can cast your big red spells quicker or unleash an X spell to end the game. Of course, if you're in a pinch, you can always just fire off some damage on a creature. And then finally, that nice big emblem. If you let Chandra take up for a few turns, you can activate her final ultimate ability and get this incredible emblem that will knock your opponent out in no time flat. She's a real powerhouse.
For Chandra, this is a very interesting journey because she's arriving on Kaladesh with the assumption that both mom and dad are dead. The reason she hasn't come back here has been very painful. She's a person who wears her heart on her sleeve and just wouldn't expose herself to this kind of hurt coming home. Through the events of this set, however, she realizes, or she when she meets PNLR, that her mom is in fact not dead. And so we're going to see what does that mean for Chandra, to know that there is family that is still alive. And we're actually also going to see that Chandra's approach to things and Pia's approach to things are not necessarily the same.
So we're going to Kaladesh, And we wanted a character that would be a great fit, a planeswalker we could put at the front and center of it that would make sense on Kaladesh. And who other than Saheeli Rai?
So Saheeli Rai is a Kaladesh native planeswalker. She's red and blue, and you know, we wanted Saheeli to be emblematic of what this world is about. And so of course that means dealing with artifacts. For Saheeli, that means being able to transmute certain metals into different ones. She basically has absolute control over the properties of metal.
Nissa, Vital Force, is another powerful Planeswalker card from the set. We tried to position this card as kind of going over the top Haymaker in a mid-range matchup. Her ultimate there is to give you a longer term value as the game goes on. So if you're in sort of two mid-range deck mirror match, that you can try to ultimate her, and then every land you draw is just drawing you into another card, and eventually over the long term you'll out-muscle your opponent in terms of card advantage. Her plus one ability does a good job defending her or attacking in a hasty fashion. It's very powerful, hitting for five right away. And then her second ability can return a permanent card from your graveyard to your hand, could even rebuy other copies of Planeswalkers or other copies of Nissa, again, playing into that sort of mid-range value type shell to kind of outlast your opponent in a longer game.
Nissa Vital Force is a new exciting incarnation of one of our favorite green Planeswalkers. Not only does she have an ultimate that you can turn on the turn after you cast her, she gets a giant 5/5 creature to protect her until you get there. It's always a tough choice whether you want to keep her around or have just massive Karna advantage for the rest of the game.
Dovin Bahn kind of gets the whole Kaladesh story going. Dovin Bahn is a Vedulkan planeswalker from Kaladesh who arrives on Ravnica to enlist the aid of the planeswalkers.
With someone like Jace or Gideon, you kind of know what that person's doing, but with a brand new planeswalker like Dovin Bahn from this set, we get to kind of start from scratch and create something really, really interesting. So the first thing we do is we look at the character. What is the creative team trying to bring to the table? And Dovin Bahn is this white-blue planeswalker who works with the consulate, and he's got a knack for finding the flaws in things. And we thought, okay, how can we bring this to a card? Well, we can make sure that he draws you cards and gains you some life. Very white-blue things, very consulate things to do. But the really cool part to me is the way he kind of finds that flaw in that creature. He gives it a little bit of a power negative, and also makes sure that its activated abilities don't turn on. He kind of exploits the little things that make the creatures tick.
In this set, in this block of just all these things that players have been asking for forever, we have one more. Who is the villain? Who's the villain of the story? Tezzeret! Tezzeret is back! Tezzeret, it's really neat to have him as a villain, and he's going to cause all sorts of problems.
One more part of Inside R&D coming your way tomorrow. Now, yesterday we had another part one. There's parts everywhere here. I suppose it's Kaladesh. There's lots of parts lying around. Well, yesterday we showed you part one of Enter the Battlefield. We went to Roanoke, Virginia. And although Walking the Plains may be gone and The Wizard may be gone, the filmmaking talents of Nate Holt and Sean Kornhauser are most definitely not lost to Magic the Gathering. It's a really exciting time in Magic. And they're away from the tournament now. And they're out in the real world, seeing the people, the places, the moments that really matter to these players who you get to see under really very stressful situations when you're at 10-2 and you're trying to claw your way to the top eight. It's a more reflective, more human piece than a little change of pace for Magic. It's great to have it. So we're going to, without further ado, here comes part two of Enter the Battlefield.
I just want to not be here anymore. Leading up to the Magic World Championship, Roanoke's Brian Brown Doohan and Brad Nelson spent a whole week in a hotel collaborating and practicing with two of their fellow competitors, Denmark's Martin Muller and Sweden's Joel Larsson. With only one day left before the tournament, they were still scrutinizing the finer points of their strategy.
Well, I don't know what you mean by heavy. Like, we're...
Like, you're going to get hands where you stall on, like, the third land, and you just have, like, three or four two-drops in your hand. You can only cast one per turn.
First sure. argument was that we were stranded with two lands and a bunch of two-drops, and we should play Citroen instead.
Pretty much we have a day left. We have to test smart at this point if we're, like, because we're all a little flimsy.
Yeah.
So, like, going through and theorizing and stuff.
think my goal here is to just not embarrass myself.
He will.
I don't want to be like the guy who went 0-14 or whatever. Like, I don't want that to be me. So obviously I want to win, but beyond that, I just don't want to be like an embarrassment to myself and all of my family and everyone who's ever been related to me or interacted with me in any way, shape, or form.
That's a lot of pressure.
Just a little bit.
While Magic players in Roanoke are already a pretty tight-knit group, Brian and Brad became attached at the hip as they prepared for the World Championship.
Testing with Brad was like perfect for the event. And in my opinion, Brad is like one of the best like theorists in the game when it comes to like metagaming and deck choices and things like that. And I think a lot of my success this year is owed to Brad anyway. Like, he's really helped me improve as like a player in a lot of different ways, so I wanted to test with him for that tournament since he was a lot of the reason that I even qualified.
Brian started his tournament by winning a bunch of matches. His fear of falling flat on his face was now firmly in the rear view.
Remember, Brian Brown Doohan is up a game, and now he's up the match. He's 6-1.
Wow.
I don't know. Did you check? He did an interview with Rich where he said, you know, I'm kind of the underdog. I'm a gold level pro in a sea of Hall of Famers and Platinums. And he says he's kind of representing the grinders out there. And I got to tell you, he's just smashing right now.
Yeah. Things went pretty well. I'm sitting at 6-1 and tied for the lead, so pretty exciting. Not where I expected to be, but certainly happy that I'm here.
Where did you expect yourself to be?
Middle of the pack, I would say. I felt like, in terms of play skill, I'm certainly on the lower end of this tournament. So many great players here, but I felt like in terms of preparation, I was going to be really close to the top.
Well, I think like his approach is very honest. You can call it being humble. I just call it being honest. At the World Championships, was he the best player in the room? No. But that doesn't matter. Once you're one of the 24, your goal is to get there. Then anything can happen. It's that honesty and the honesty that he has to be able to look in the mirror and say, this is about how good I am. These guys are probably a little bit better than me, but I can still beat these people.
Unfortunately for Brad, his tournament wasn't going nearly as well.
Looking back at BBD's run at Worlds, I feel very proud for my friend and happy, but I will say that during the event, there was a lot of bitterness and jealousy since I was having a very middling tournament while he was just winning round after round. It was difficult to swallow in the moment, but then once my tournament was over, all of that went away and all I cared about was watching my friend win the tournament.
After playing 14 rounds in 3 different formats across 3 days, Brian finished with 10 wins, 3 losses, 1 draw, and a seat at the Sunday table to play for the trophy. His semifinal opponent was Hall of Famer Shota Yasuoka. With Brad coming to terms with his disappointing finish, Brian turned to the 2015 world champion, Seth Manfield, to help him prepare against the highly skilled Shota.
So we've played 4 games, and that was the first one I've won. So it's going worse than expected. I thought this would be a really strong matchup, but he has 2 declarations in his main deck, so if he draws those often, I'm probably in trouble.
What do you think Brian's chances are in this matchup tomorrow?
Thinking about it, I was thinking BBD would be ahead. Now after having playing games, I'm kind of rethinking it. Because a lot of people play games against Bant Company, but they're not playing against like the best possible opponent. Shota is literally the best possible opponent playing the best deck in the format. So I'm not trying to say anything bad about BBD. He's great. I am a little bit concerned at this point.
Brian surprised his peers and himself by defeating Shota with blisteringly fast attacks that poured in damage before the Japanese superstar could mount a defense. Suddenly, in what felt like the blink of an eye, Brian found himself in a rather surreal place.
In that 6 for BBD, that's going to fire off and put that Jace back in Shota's hand, and that will be the game and the match for BBD here. He is advancing into the finals here of our World Championship.
What has this experience playing in this tournament been like for you?
I mean, it's just been completely unbelievable. Like, this has been something I've wanted to play in for a really long time. And it's just been amazing. And I've had so much fun playing this tournament. Even though it's supposed to be stressful, I've just been like having a blast and playing as well as I can. And things have just gone really well for me.
tell me about how satisfied versus disappointed you'll be whether you take first or second after the finals.
Well, if I take first, it would be like unbelievably great. I'd be able to be a world champion. And if I take second, then I'm just like the guy who got second place at Worlds. I'm way further than I expected to be, and I cannot complain about my finish regardless of what happens.
Brian's opponent in the finals was Portugal's Marcio Carvalho. He was playing a similar deck to Brian's, and the match was mired in a stalemate for long stretches.
Future clues, like it was actually really bad for Marcio that he didn't hit a land there. He was really hoping to draw a land.
Archangel Avacyn's gonna attack.
Game 3 alone lasted over an hour, and Game 4 was another nail-biter. Ultimately, Brian broke through the stalemates, decimated Carvalho's battlefield, and won the series 3-1.
Gotten to that point where it looked like he was going to win. I was just couldn't believe it. it was so exciting.
I was so impressed with just his calm composure and his professionalism. Just extremely proud of my son for being the world champion. Been unbelievable, I guess that's what I have to say.
I always have the ability to say, you know, like I was the world champion, and that's always like a tangible like accomplishment that I have achieved, and I will always have that. But at the end of the day, like there's still other goals I can achieve, and I'm still like trying to reach new goals. So it's not like I don't want to fall back on winning the world championship as like it's okay that I'm doing bad at Magic now because I won the world championship. Like I don't want that to be how I am. I want it to be like, I won the world championship, that's awesome, that's something I'll always have, but now here's the next thing I'm trying to conquer.
Fantastic stuff. There we are, enter the battlefield, the series. And if it's a series, well, it's more than just those two parts, because Nate and Sean are going to be out and about on the road around the world. Now, coming up later in the year, it'll be the World Magic Cup. And I have it on reasonably good authority that Nate and Sean are going to be out in one of the most vibrant, passionate, incredible Magic communities around Latin America. Enter the Battlefield is coming your way later this year. So strap in for that. That is going to be great fun at the World Magic Cup. Nate and Sean, two of the great magic storytellers around today. Can't wait to see more from the guys. But right now, it is time to turn our attention back to Pro Tour Kaladesh. We've got stories waiting to be told, and they involve wins and losses in high-pressure matches. So it's time to mark your card for the standard rounds ahead. It's time for our standard review.